can't do business with Hitler. We are now at war. There are but two alternatives, total victory or total defeat. There can be no such thing as a military stalemate that would result in the survival of Hitlerism. That is the opinion of a man who knows, Douglas Miller, for 15 years commercial attaché to the American Embassy in Berlin,
presenting a radio series entitled You Can't Do Business with Hitler.
Episode 6, The Spoils of Europe.
Douglas Miller speaking. Today, in Europe, the Nazi armies of occupation carry forward the greatest mass looting in history. Conquered countries are being systematically stripped of their raw materials, their gold reserves, their railroad equipment, their factory machinery, and even of their food supplies. France is the most tragic example of all. The looting of France began on June 22, 1940, when, following the defeat of the French armies, French and German officers met in the historical railroad car at Compiègne to discuss armistice terms.
We expect, gentlemen, that in accordance with international law, France will pay the cost of maintaining the German army of occupation.
We cannot object to that. What is the sum expected of us?
400 million francs a day.
That seems very exorbitant.
We don't find it so.
Pardon if I insist that it is. Surely you can maintain your army of occupation on one-tenth of that amount.
I am not authorized to bargain with you.
General Keitel, you speak of international law. May I point out that international law does not sanction payments 10 times in excess of the actual cost of occupation.
I am not authorized to bargain.
General Keitel, this is all impossible. I cannot attach my signature to such a clause.
May I remind you, General, that hostilities cannot end until this armistice is concluded. Even while we speak, the German Air Force is bombing your city of Bordeaux.
Bordeaux? But Bordeaux is an open city. There are no soldiers, there are only civilians. Why should you attack it?
General, have you forgotten our countries are at war?
Of course, but why not a truce while we discuss this armistice?
There shall be no truce until this armistice is signed.
And the raids on Bordeaux shall continue?
Precisely. Come, General Huntinger, your decision.
Give me your pen.
Every American newspaper carried the story of how, because of the threat to Bordeaux, the French representatives had been forced to accept these harsh terms. At the time, however, few of us realized just how completely the armistice had prepared the looting of France. Let me show you what was behind all this. Following the armistice, Adolf Hitler appointed a Nazi officer named von Stechitz as commander of the Nazi Army of Economic Occupation. Within a few days following this appointment, German soldiers started dismantling French factories in preparation for shipping French machinery to the Reich.
Monsieur Godet, come quickly. They're stealing our machinery.
Oh, what are you talking about, Pierre? Who is stealing our machinery?
Soldiers, German soldiers. Please, monsieur, come to the factory with me and stop them.
That won't be necessary.
How did you get in here? Who are you?
Permit me to introduce myself, Herr Godet. I am Colonel Berfoken of the German Army of Occupation.
What do you want?
Your machinery, Herr Corday. My soldiers are busy now removing it.
You steal my property?
You don't understand, Herr Corday. Everything is proper and according to French law. We are purchasing your property.
Colonel Berfoken, do you mean you will actually pay me for my machinery?
Naturally. Name your price.
Well, the machinery is valued at 450,000 marks.
Good. Oberleutnant! Come into here.
Jawohl, mein Colonel.
You want me, mein Colonel?
Yeah, you will give the gentleman the envelope containing the money.
Jawohl. You are 450,000 marks.
Now, if you will just sign this paper here, this Herr Corte, this is a transfer of title, stating that you have been fully paid and that the machinery now legally belongs to us. On the dotted line, Herr Corte.
Very well. Yes.
Dankeschön. Good day, Herr Corday.
Stop. Don't let him go.
But what's wrong?
This money. Look at it. The ink is coming off of my hand.
Well, let me see. Yes, you're right. Colonel Berfoken, well, what does this mean?
Oh, it merely means that the money was only recently printed.
Recently printed? And these are not Reichsmarks. These are Reichskreditstrafenmarks.
Yeah, so?
So of what value are they?
The value is printed on them quite clearly.
But
Your own bank in Berlin won't even accept them. How can you say they are of any value?
You do not understand principles of banking, Herr Korte. Let me quote our eminent minister of finance, Schwerin Graf Gorsisch. Value of money is based not on the ability of the country issuing the money to pay, but on the ability of the holder of the money to collect. I did not.
Without a cent of capital, a stock, a bond, or any other collateral whatsoever, the Nazis printed more than 3 billion Reichskreditkassen marks. This worthless paper money was used to pay for various goods taken from the French. Unbelievable?
Fantastic?
Of course.
But if you want proof, read France on Berlin Time.
See page 58. This book was written by the well-known authority Thomas Kernan, who was an actual eyewitness of the plundering of France. Not all French factories were stripped of the machinery, of course. Some the Nazis left intact. These were used to turn out tanks, airplanes, and other instruments of war for the German army. However, the greatest coup of all was yet to come. Let us return once more to General von Spetsius, appointed by Hitler as commander of the Nazi Army of Economic Occupation. In the fall of 1940, von Spetsius conferred with a high Nazi official named Dr. Karl Schäfer.
As you know, General Spetsius, the Führer has appointed me co-director of the Bank of France.
What are your plans, Doctor?
The Führer is not satisfied. Most French property is still legally owned by Frenchmen. The new order will not be completely organized until all key industries in Europe are not only controlled, but actually owned by Germans.
What is to be done?
I have a plan. Even now, my staff are examining the books of the Bank of France.
I don't understand.
Oh, this is too complicated to explain fully now. I'll contact you within a few days.
Schaefer's plans were laid very carefully. His staff gave him a long list bearing the names of French corporations owing money to the Bank of France. Nearly every important industrial house in France was on that list. And then...
Monsieur, today you will call in all of
them. Dr. Schaefer, I don't understand.
Let me explain. On examining your book, I discover hundreds of corporations owing money to your bank. You have a perfect right to demand that this money be paid.
But that is not the way the bank operates. It has always been our policy to give our debtors plenty of warning before calling in a loan. Otherwise, how can they have time to collect the money to pay us?
That is their concern, not ours. You will do as you are told. Call in all loans immediately.
Within a few days, the owners of French industry were rushing to the bank to plead for time.
I represent the Fessenay Aluminum Company of France.
I am very pleased to meet you. You have with you the money you owe the bank?
If you could just give us a few weeks, Dr. Schaefer.
I'm sorry, that's impossible. The money is due now.
You won't seize my company.
Don't worry, monsieur. We have no intention of seizing your company. You will discover that we Germans can be most generous. Your company, like hundreds of others, will merely sell more stuff. Thus, you can secure money to pay the debt you owe.
Yes, but that means that these new purchases might very possibly gain a controlling interest in my company.
Of course. But you have no objection to sharing your properties with your countrymen, have you?
Well, it's better than losing everything, at least. Very well, Dr. Schaefer. I'll do as you suggest.
Thus, by such pressure measures, the Nazis forced French businessmen to sell controlling interests in their properties. Frenchmen were led to believe that these controlling interests would merely pass into the hands of other Frenchmen. But what actually happened?
I've been waiting to hear from you, Dr. Schaefer. Your plans are complete?
Jawohl. The Bank of France has called in all loans, General Spectre. Frenchmen will be unable to pay. They will be forced to sell everything.
But who will buy?
Who has money to buy? Remember, the French have been paying us 400 million francs a day, which we supposedly use to maintain our army of occupation. The surplus has accumulated. So, with the money furnished us by the French, we shall buy them out. Now listen, I want you to bring German businessmen from Berlin secretly. When the sale of French properties begins, they shall suddenly appear and buy up everything. They shall be supplied with francs. Understand?
Perfectly. Everything shall be arranged. As it is.
This cold-blooded plan was carried out with the greatest efficiency. And thus today, all the key industries of France are legally owned by Germans. And the properties were purchased with money the Germans had extorted from the French people under terms of the Franco-German armistice. The French did not realize how completely they had been duped until the new stockholders began to appear at stockholders' meetings.
Gentlemen, gentlemen, the meeting will now come to order. Gentlemen of the Pechenez Aluminum Company, recently, in order to pay a debt owed to the Bank of France, we were forced to float a large percentage of new stock. However, as chairman of this board, I see no reason why this development should affect the policy of this company.
One moment. I think you are out of order here.
Out of order? I don't understand.
Permit me to introduce myself and my associates. Schwarz, Freiheiler, Herr Hindler, Puhpapa, and I, gentlemen, am Herr Müller. Now, gentlemen, at the recent sale of stock, I and my associates purchased 55% of the stock of this company. Gentlemen, we represent Hermann Gehring Incorporated. Yes,
Hermann Gehring? Then you're German.
Yeah, we are German. And gentlemen, since we own a controlling interest in this company, we have elected myself captain. And now, monsieur, if you'll just hand over your gavel and vacate that seat at the head of the table.
Thus have the Nazis become the new owners not only of France, but of all Europe. They own the Christensen nickel mine of Norway, the Algemeine Kunstzijde Une Rayon Company of Holland, the National Bank of Belgium, the Steyr Auto Works of Austria, the Foraki Romanes Petroleum Company of Romania, the Skoda Steel and Munitions Company of Czechoslovakia, the Schork and Belivo Magnesium Mines of Yugoslavia, and so on ad nauseum. These are cold facts. They can be checked in a variety of authentic sources. For example, Reveille's book, Spoils of Europe, see chapter 19. Or Lorwyn's Economic Consequences of the Second World War, or in numerous magazine or newspaper articles. However, the best proof of all is supplied by the Nazis themselves. Here are the words of Reich Minister Richard Walter Dahr as spokesman for Adolf Hitler.
With complete deliberation and without sentimentality, we shall destroy Europe. All soil and industrial property of the inhabitants of non-German origin will be confiscated without exception and distributed primarily among worthy members of the Nazi Party. Thus, a new aristocracy of German masters will be created. This aristocracy will have slaves assigned to it. These slaves will be their property and will consist of landless non-German nationals.
You can't do business with Hitler. You have been listening to episode 6 in a series entitled You Can't Do Business with Hitler. This series is based upon the experiences and observations of Douglas Miller, who was for 15 years commercial attaché to the American Embassy in Berlin. Listen for the 7th program in the series, which is entitled The Thousand Year Reich. This transcribed program, written and directed by Frank Telford, was brought to you by the radio section of the Office for Emergency Management in Washington.
Cases from official files. Technical advice comes from the Office of Chief of Police W.H. Parker, Los Angeles Police Department.
Miss Reeves, there's a wall where your door used to be.
Yes, so?
So, the thing is, nobody can get in and out of your office.
It's great, isn't it?
Great.
Thanks to Administaff, I can do everything right here in my office. The door was superfluous.
Yeah, but how do you...
keep up on company operations?
Well...
I've got my phone, my email, and Administaff's online services. It's a great... great time to be alive, Augie.
Alive? When you're walled off from the world?